All right. We are live. It is Thursday. I'm Mazvita Maraire. This is Cascadia Sports.net. Oh, Seattle Sports Weekly. Yeah, yeah. Feeling real good. I stumbled, mumbled, just because I just realized I had my Roosevelt High School football shirt on, sweatshirt that I was given a long time ago. And Roosevelt is number one. You want to know in Metro right now? Well, then this low division. I shouldn't say that. There's like two divisions, and so Rough Riders are leading the one division, and then so they're in the playoffs for the first time in a long, long time. And unfortunately, we won't be able to talk about that. There will be no Metro Sports Weekly tonight, and we'll be back next week. I should just make sure, but I will. Other than that, we will talk pro sports, college sports, because that's kind of what we do here. But we're never, never, never too hotty and high to talk about high school sports, because that's where it goes. So, but if you want an in-depth analysis on high school, the Metro League sports, definitely tune into Metro Sports Weekly. So, all right, we are talking about professional sports right now, and so we go to the Seahawks. Before I go there, I didn't even say for those that celebrate Happy Halloween. I like it because I'm a sci-fi person. I'm a sci-fi and also kind of a horror, the classic ones, the Draculas and those things. I just always like those movies. I like that genre, but I think the classic ones, Frankenstein, Boris Karloff, and how those were done. And they were a little bit of a mystery, a little bit of gore there. They try to scare you somewhat, but as time went on, I'm not a fan of the whole of where it went. And that, in terms of where it went, is the slashers, and I think the Dawn of the Dead was good, those ones, but once it got so repetitive and it just become more gory and the blood, I just kind of tune that off. That's not my style, and people get locked up in rooms and things like that. And those things, nah, I think it's, yeah, it becomes a little, for me, it moves away from that genre. But, if you're around Columbia City today, our studios are there, Columbia City Theater, DJ Smooth T, we'll be playing music on the street and passing out candy. So, that's what we like to do. Rainier Avenue Radio App, where we are in the spirit of it. And, trick or treat, candy. It sounds like, man, he's got the candy part done. And if DJ spinning, playing music, well, there's your treat right there. So, trick and treat. So, yeah, that's, I do. I mean, I love this time of the year. And Halloween to me is the ultimate adult holiday. There's really no other one. Now, I'm way beyond the age of going out there, but in the big cities, people dress up, and there's just parties, and there's event, music and those kinds of things, and it's fun. I mean, it's the only one. It's the only holiday for adults. All the other ones, if you think about it, are for families. Well, that they should. They're for kids and all the good stuff. And so, I do. I like it. And as I said, for me, I celebrate it. I'll watch, significant somebody or by myself, whatever the case may be, that season, if you will. And I'll watch a good movie. And the old ones, as I said, nicely done, well written. And then go to bed. So that's how that goes. So happy Halloween to those that celebrate it, and those that don't. We'll leave it at that. And I do need to circle back. Just Rainier Avenue Radio we'll broadcast in the state football playoffs this Friday at 5 p.m. Shawcrest against, they'll take on the O'Day Irish Memorial Stadium. And the winner will go to the state round of 16. So that's a big game. And Shawcrest being in the Wesco and O'Day being number two in the Metro, obviously with 9-0 record. And yeah. So if you can get out there, a couple good things for you to do today, you know, the Rainier Avenue Radio, broadcasting music outside, as I said, DJ Smoothie T will be out there handing out candy so you can take the little ones or the big ones. And then on Friday, hop on down to Memorial Stadium for that big playoff game, 5 p.m. Shawcrest Scots, I think they are, against the O'Day Irish. All right, so we get to talk a little bit. As I said, the Seahawks, they pull off a interesting win, 24-20. It's a big win for them. I going into this game, they beat the Cleveland Browns. Going into this game, this was the one I said they really need to win this game. Because Sunday they're in Baltimore. And why I said that is the Seahawks schedule, well, that it should. They play a lot of really tough teams here. And there's some games coming up that you can go, okay, that one is, it's not, it makes sense if they lose that game. And the way they've been playing, Seattle is minus Menos a little bit. So what you saw on Sunday, man, they come out for the first couple drives, score on both of them 14-0 against a Cleveland Browns defense. Going in, the Browns defense was number one overall. And so it was like, wow, well, it's quite a surprise. Seahawks come out there, offense is clicking. And why the Browns were number one in the NFL is their ability to make changes, to adjust. And that's exactly what they did. The Seahawks get a field goal, so they're up 17-7. And the Hawks didn't score until 38 seconds left in the fourth quarter. And of course, that was the most talked about play. One of the most talked about plays right now was when Jamal Adams, Browns have the ball. Jamal Adams heads the ball. Basically, he's rushing on a blitz. He heads the ball and it goes right into Julian Love's hands. Seahawks offense gets the ball and they actually converted. You've got to like that. That was Jackson Smith and the Jigba, the rookie, in on your pass from Geno. But many questions need to be asked, are being asked. But, you know, going in, it was always, what's going on with Geno? You know, is he the quarterback? And again, the issue last game is he had an interception, he had a fumble. And so then again, the one thing you cannot have from your quarterback is the turnovers, right? Because that's just, you can't have that. And so he had two interceptions. He was 23 of 37 for 254. And then, you know, two interceptions, two touchdowns. For me, Geno Geno got what he needed as a quarterback last game. He got the signature game-winning drive, and you need that as a quarterback to restore, if you will, confidence in the team and yourself, right? Because you are judged by wins at the end of the day. We're going to go to Pete Carroll. I'm going to hear about that and hear him talk about, that at the end, we won, and that's all that matters. And there's, we can dissect the good video on here. We dissect the game, but in the end, that's what you want in Geno. That's what you expect, right? Lose the turnovers, and then from there, he'll manage the game. He's a good, there's the play right there. Game managers are very good at that, managing the game. And so, yeah, you get that signature, game-winning drive underneath your belt. It's like I said, it restores confidence in yourself and the team. And what it does, it buys him a couple games. Next Sunday, they're in Baltimore. And so that is not, you know, that's a hostile environment, if I've ever seen one. And the Ravens, you know, they lead the AFC South, if you will. And so it's one that is the one game at the top here when I said, you know, if you lose that one, right, you play well, you want to win that game, but if you lose in Baltimore to the Ravens, they're first in the AFC North, you're okay with that. I mean, you can take that as long as you play well, because the Ravens, you know, they beat the Cardinals 31-24, and they're coming off of their most impressive win was actually a couple before that when they beat the Detroit Lions. Everybody's remember Seattle beat the Lions, and the Lions went and beat everybody else until they ran into the Ravens. And you know the Ravens, Lamar Jackson, and a stout defense, another one. In fact, probably, you know, number-wise, the Ravens defense might now overtake the Browns defense, but it is a murder's row for the Seahawks. And, you know, if they can play well, sure. They just have to play well. Maybe they can sneak a win there, but I don't know. Murder's row, as I was saying, is after Baltimore, Seahawks will host Cleveland, will host Washington here. Then they're at the Rams, San Francisco, at Dallas, at San Francisco, Philly, at Tennessee, Pittsburgh, and Arizona. Boy, that's, you know, I know we're getting ahead of ourselves here, but that is a murderer's row. But you know what? That's why the win over the Browns was important. And remember, the Seahawks are number one in the NFC West. They're 5-2. 49ers are 5-4-3. They're 5-3. So they played one more game. But I mean, that's what's at stake here just in terms of in this season. And the Seahawks, surprise, surprise, the Seahawks picked up Leonard Williams. And like, well, who's Leonard Williams? This was a really good pick there because Leonard Williams is 6'5", 300-pound lineman. He's a D lineman. The Seahawks sent a 2024 second round pick and a 2025 round pick, and a fifth round pick in 2025 to New York in exchange for Williams. And the Seahawks only paying out of pocket $647,000. That's all they're paying. And so the other team is picking up the tab for Williams. I mean, it really is a good pick. And you're kind of saying the Giants, I should say, why are you doing that? Because one of the things the Seahawks are trying to do, they lost Uchenna Nwosu, even though he is a rushing linebacker, is right now the Seahawks, what's making the defense click is Draymond Jones, Jaron Reed. I get it, and all the other players, but what the Seahawks have got right now, and Mario Edwards, is the getting push up front, right? In the 3-4 defense that they play, those three linemen, if they're able to push, right, and make it difficult for teams to run up the middle and put pressure, then you've got your edge rushers coming in. Remember, they picked up Frank Clark, re-signed him again. And as I said, they lost Uchenna Nwosu, but, you know, Boyan Mafe has had 5 sacks in 5 games. So now you can rotate Reed, Jones, Edwards, and Williams. And so that's the key you want. You want to keep those D-line fresh and rotating because, you know, unlike the safeties and somewhat the linebackers, it's a hard position to play the D-line. I mean, you're going 100 miles and 110, if you will, every play. You got to read, react, boom, and away you go. Every play. Come back, boom, read, react. And so that's why the Seahawks are going to this kind of, you know what, let's rotate, let's get as many as we can. And part of why the Williams trade makes sense is this, is that, you know, the draft is great, but this guy was the number one draft pick in the top 10. Seahawks in 2015, Seahawks don't usually draft that high and able to get a D-line. Well, you're saying, okay, Devin Witherspoon. Well, you saw that, right? You see what happens when you get a top five pick. So the way they looked at it, John Schneider was like, you know what? If we can get a top 10 pick, this guy was a top 10 pick. He's ready. He's playing. Now, I get it. He's getting a little old there. But in terms of, sure, let's give up the draft picks. Let's get paid dividends now. This might be what can take us not only to win the division, but to a championship. Because, again, in the draft, once you draft out of the first round, you know, as I said, they got a second-round pick in 2024. You don't really know how that second-round pick is going to pan out. You hope it should. Seahawks have done well. And then also that fifth-round pick in 2025. What you do is you go, do you think that those two picks, are we going to be able to mold a player? Are we guaranteed? No, there's no guarantees. Well, let's get this guy now. We know Williams can help. He can take us to the next level. So there it is. So let me see. We'll try this. I think we got this down pat. So we're going to hear from Pete Carroll. And I wonder from yesterday's I just don't know. This is a Pete Carroll press conference from yesterday. And he's going to talk about, we'll take this video. This is Pete Carroll press conference on Monday.
It really starts with the run game for us. And that's kind of old hat for you to hear that. But that's where we began this season, you know, going after, trying to show that we could, you know, play the running game. And that takes the most discipline. It takes the most, you know, commitment and focus. And we thought it was a great place, and Clint thought it was a great place to start, you know, and to build from. And so way back, we've been on that for some time now, and it's given us a baseline, really. This isn't always going to be great, but it is where we start from. And then
And there you go. That's I'm going to cut that short because that's the intro just in terms of Pete Carroll talking about, you know, the team and why they the philosophy in stopping the run. Because for them, that's really what it's about in terms of Seattle and why they're doing everything that you're seeing. You got to stop the run. You got to get this Mary Edwards in. I mean, you got to get, you know, the Williams, Draymond Jones, Mario Edwards, and Jeremy. If you can stop that run, that is really how you can be very, very, successful in terms of this league. And you have to be able to do that in terms of you stop the run, it'll make your defense better. And that's what really what the Seahawks are trying to do here, just in terms of, their best defense and how they can become one of those rare opportunity, a rare chance that they had. So we're going to go there. And so trying to pop the – oh, I see what happens here. Okay, so we're going to go with we're going to hear from Pete from yesterday. And all right. This will really – we go there. All right, we'll try this again. See if we can't get Pete Carroll talking about yesterday. And again, it's a press conference. There's more in this video in terms of he'll really talk about. We can get it up here. Pete will talk about why they picked up Edwards and everything else. So here we go. So let's hear from Pete Carroll.
Analyze yet until, you know, until he arrives, coming in probably by midday tomorrow, something like that. But it's what's reported is accurate, you know, out there.
What do you like about him?
Oh man, everything. We watched him for a long time, you know, I've known of him for a good while, Trojan and all that, you know, and he's a fantastic football player, and he's the kind of guy that can, you know, make a difference in games. He's really a nice player. Yeah, I think he's a little different. His style is different, you know, and he's a, you know, a classic three technique. You know, he's been doing that for a long part of his career, and he's really good at it. And he's an all-around player. He's versatile, run and pass. Rush the passer, cause issues and problems for your opponent. He's a terrific kid. He's a leader and a competitor and just the kind of guy that, you know, you're fortunate to have on your team. He can play anywhere, just like you said. He can play five technique, he can play three technique, and he plays on the center as well. He's done all of that. So he brings a lot of versatility.
Did you feel depth was needed, additional depth was needed?
Just competing, just trying to get better, you know, just looking for a way to try to help us. This is one of the late opportunities to do something like that. And John did a beautiful job of, you know, figuring it out and how to work it and pick out a guy that really fits and can be a part of this team. I'm really excited for our guys to get to know Leonard, you know, and see who he is and what he's all about. His competitiveness is really very similar to the guys that we have in this program. And he's going to fit in great. Yeah, those are the first guys I wanted to talk about in the team meeting today. You know, talk about what a terrific job that Charles did, giving Miles all the credit. He's a fantastic football player, but Charles really did well in battling with him. He wound up, you know, flipping the other side. And when our guys had shots on the other side, they did well too. You saw Jason was in the last drive, you know, and he had Miles on his side the whole time, and we made it through the drive, you know, and he didn't wreck the drive, which he can do. So I was really praised the three tackles for doing a fine job in general against a really good edge group. And I thought that was really an exciting part of this game. Really, we're trying to get out of that thought that you can't rotate offensive linemen. You know, we're just trying to grow through that, because why is that? We rotate guys everywhere, you know, and particularly guys that have earned their way and they're worthy of being out there. They deserve to play, and it makes us better if they do play. You know, just as you go down the road and you need guys, it's worked out for us the entire first part of this season. Everybody's played. I mean, everybody's played. You know, and all the rotations and all of that. I no longer. Well, you know, ascribe to the thought that you can't rotate offensive linemen. We've already proven that. So it's a good part of our thought process, I think, and it helps us.
How are Phil and Abe doing?
Phil should be back this week. He should be ready to go. Abe is not ready yet. Very impressive ball game for him. Gauging from how bad he felt just the night before, I mean, 9 o'clock at night, you know, the night before, he figured it out, and the docs got through it and helped him, and he made it. So. He was very tuned in the game. He played a really nice game.
I think he had 5 catches, but on 14 targets. Was it?
No, that wasn't by design.
No, I just
want to. I guess this is exactly the way we wanted it. Yeah. No, we need to do better there.
Pete, with so many offensive linemen playing, what does that say about Andy Dickerson? He's able to.
Yeah, I mean. I'm glad you brought it up. Yeah, I think Andy and Khalil are doing a fantastic job with these guys. To be able to handle that and handle the mentality of the guys in the room and the confidence level that takes and how all that is kind of navigated, you know, in their meetings and on the practice field, I think is really an obvious statement about their ability to handle this thing. So I think Andy's done a great job. Yeah, well, I'm gonna find out more about it. I have questions about some stuff that happened in the game, and I'm just curious to hear what the guys say, you know. But you can't contact them in the face. There is a likelihood when your hands are in here that sometimes it goes up and it elevates some, you know, the guy's head a little bit. I don't think that's at all what they're trying to call. That's not what they want to call. And so we have to be really careful about it. We have to adjust. We can't wait for anybody else to adjust. We have to adjust. But I still want to know more. It was a point of emphasis too, I believe, this week, you know, in their messaging that they send us, and I'm still curious.
All over the field, or defensive backs in particular, the emphasis?
No, it was the guys up front too. Yeah.
Jamal, you guys, you said you kept Jamal out for a few plays, kind of just with his knee. How is that going? I mean, with his knee and everything. And
we're still working on it. We're still trying to find the right rhythm of how much to play him until he builds up enough week by week, you know, work here to where we can find the right rhythm, you know, because he was sore last week, and it took him late in the week before he was really ready to go. So it was good that he made it and played and all that. But we have to, we're trying to figure out how to manage that. And it's really, it's always the, what happens after you play, you know, how do you feel? And so, well, I don't know anything today on that, but we're working on it. So we're trying to just find the happy medium of play time, reps, and until he can really build up the tolerance. He did great at the beginning and the end. In the middle, we weren't as clean, you know. What we didn't do is we didn't get the explosive plays with the field positions that we took advantage of in the first quarter, and we took advantage of in the winning drive too, you know. I think I said this in this morning, but when you play a really good defense, it's hard to go the whole field. I mean, I bet they haven't had a handful of times all year long that somebody's gone 80 yards on them or 75 yards on them. And so we did that. We did take advantage of the short fields and did well by it. And we created the change that went with DK's big catch and with Kenny's big run. Without those plays, it would have been really hard to score on those drives also, you know. Those were 40-yard plays. And so, you know, we needed to find a couple explosions in there that would change the field position to give us a chance to, you know, to work our way through in the scoring zone and all. But I think Gino played winning football. He got it done, you know. We had a miss, you know, a mishap on a play, the guy tips the ball up and all, we don't see it right, but that's, you know, stuff's going to happen. We need to do better around it. I love that he won the game.
I'm mute there. There you go, Pete Carroll, and that Monday morning press conference from yesterday. So we were there, and he was just kind of going through all the things I had talked about at the top. We heard him talk about Geno and emphasis on winning football. And as I said, you know, Geno gets that game-winning drive, and that's the reference there. And you heard him talk about the new player there, Williams. And I should note that Williams played for the Giants before he came with, you know, that's where they got him from, obviously. And a quick stats here. Let's see. Game logs. Yeah, so he's got they lose to New York Jets. That's what it is. And against the loss in the Jets, he had an assist, a tackle we're talking about here. And then they played the Washington Commanders, and he had two tackles on that, two solos, and he had two quarterback hits. And what else? I think this one was interesting. The Jets lost to the San Francisco 49ers 24-3. And in that game, he had a solo tackle, one assist. And then that was Seattle against the San Francisco 49ers. He had six combined, so he had four solo tackles, two assists, and two quarterback hits. So hey, you know, don't put it past him. I mean, it really made sense. So, you know, the 49ers and the Seahawks are going to tangle twice. As I said, the first one will be on Thanksgiving, and if they play like 10 days later, so that, you know. And again, Williams also is he was teammates with Julian Love and Jamal Adams. And man, I saw Adams at the Sounders game last night and talked to him a little bit. And so we'll hear a little bit, because we're going to go on break in just a moment here. And just, yeah, be careful what you ask for, because legend Peter Hattrup's going to come on. We still haven't done a Husky segment. So yeah. I'm going to drag him on so he can kind of, we'll talk football and football. You know what? I want to ask him about that, because for me, I don't get it. Look, there's football and there's soccer. So all that other stuff, I would like to hear legend's perspective, but we're going to put him on the spot. And look, the guy's a legend. He can do just about anything. So we're going to go on break. We'll bring back the legend, U.S. soccer legend, Peter Hattrup, and we'll talk Huskies. And then we'll talk to Sounders, who won 2-0 over FC Dallas. All right. So coming up, as I said, Peter Hattrup, we're going to go on break. D-Money, take us to the break. And we'll be right back on Seattle Sports Weekly. I'm Mazvita Maraire.
This is Paul Pearson, host of Star Time. And when I'm not busy tearing the roof off the suckers, I'm listening to Rainier Avenue Radio.world.
Love food? Here's some storage tips to keep it fresh longer. Store cut fruits and vegetables in the fridge. Place in reusable containers. Keep bread in the freezer for longer storage. 40% of food in the U.S. goes uneaten. Save money, save food, save the planet. Visit Seattle Public Utilities for more tips.
You're listening to Rainier Avenue Radio.world. I'm Granville Emerson, along with my partner, Ronald Pepe
Bean.
And we host the show Little Line Sports right here on Rainier Avenue Radio.world, where we talk about football, basketball,
local sports,
national sports,
Seahawks,
UW, Seattle U Redhawks,
Garfield Bulldogs,
all that and more right here on Little Line Sports on Rainier Avenue Radio.world.
This is Big Poppy, host of Jazz from the Cabinets. Join me each week for a listening tour of the first century of jazz, an eclectic mix of Dixieland, big band, cool jazz, bebop, contemporary jazz, world jazz in all forms. That's Jazz from the Cabinets with Big Poppy on Rainier Avenue Radio, streaming worldwide on RainierAvenueRadio.world.
We must all remain committed to slow the spread of coronavirus, taking care of ourselves and not putting others in harm's way, especially those already at higher risk of getting seriously ill, including people over 65 or those with underlying medical conditions. If you must be out, avoid crowded areas, stay 6 feet or 2 arm lengths away from others, and wear a face covering. Wash hands frequently with soap and water for 20 seconds, especially after being in public spaces. Avoid touching your face, cough or sneeze in a tissue, then throw it away. Disinfect frequently touched objects. And if you have symptoms of fever, dry cough, and shortness of breath, call your healthcare provider before going to their office. Slowing coronavirus means taking care of ourselves while also protecting others. Even if you're not at high risk, these steps should be taken to help slow the spread of coronavirus. We are all in this together.
Your community radio station will provide you with more information. Rainier Avenue Radio.
All right, we are back on Seattle Sports Weekly. I'm Mazvita Maraire, and again, there's my niece, Chuaniso. So, that's who we play out of the break, and so smooth. She's a world-renowned musician. May she, rest her soul in peace, and she's out there. But amazing tune out there, yeah. She's got a few albums, so. It's kind of cool. It's a flex. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, it's a flex. And your little niece is, you know, you can pop on her little music on your show, and one of the top selling albums in Zimbabwe of all time. So, but music is what did Stevie Wonder say? Music is a universal language. And love is the key. Yeah, there you go. All right. So, what we're going to talk about right now with Peter Hattrup, the legend, soccer legend. We're going to talk a little football, actually, and we'll talk a little Husky football. Peter, you ready? We'll do a little Husky talk, and then we'll get to the Sounders.
I am ready.
Before we get there, let me ask you this. What did you think? Think of the trade, the Seahawks trade. You like that?
We'll see. I mean, it's worth trying to upgrade. You know, we got to try, and they're in a situation where maybe the Mariners were, and it's time to go out and try and strengthen the team rather than tread water. So I think when you see you're in a position to maybe get a home field advantage in the playoffs, you got to take a gamble every now and then to see how good you can get.
Yeah, well said. That's exactly right. I mean, you know, I'm probably, you know, talking to Peter. It's actually a really good move. I think it's a can't miss in any way, right? And players from the Seahawks know him. They played with him. And this guy was a captain for 2 years in a row. So, but Petey's 6'5". 300 pounds. It's a way to clog the middle there, don't you think?
It's going to clog the middle, and what scares me is how fast somebody that size moves over a short distance. You know, they might not be able to run 30 yards or 40 yards fast, but over 5 or 10, those big guys can move.
Absolutely. All right, let's talk a little Husky football. Do you have season tickets? Because, you know, Legends got tickets to everywhere. Does the family have season tickets?
No, I wish I did. Coaching kind of gets in the way of too many Saturday afternoon games. Though my first quote-unquote job was walking around selling Post-Intelligencer papers before Seahawks or for Husky games. When they were still going for a dime or a quarter. So we had to sell a lot of papers to make any money.
That's right. And for those of you that are like, what is the Post-Intelligencer? That is it. The short version was a PI, and it was the competing newspaper with the Seattle Times, right?
Yeah, it was the morning edition. It came out in the morning. The Times came out in the afternoon. And, it was around for a long time. It's the former sponsor of the Seattle Sports Star of the Year Awards.
Yes.
PI Sports Star.
Do you remember the Sporting Green? Remember how cool that was?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, all that stuff there's part of me that's still nostalgic to be able to get up and look through the box scores in the newspaper, you know, whether it's for basketball or baseball or whatever it was, times have changed. I'm trying to catch up, but I still look back at it and with fond memories of those papers.
Yeah, and, kind of the same with you. I held on till I could. You know, I was still getting the morning delivery of the Seattle Times because I loved that whole, the feel of the newsprint. You know, I haven't gone to journalism. They sold us on the fact that you could just take that paper and stack it somewhere, and then, hey, 3-4 days later, you could pick it up. There was just something about that. But, I went to the Times edition, online, and I still try to see the box score. But you know what? It's something clicked because now it's more research-based, and I hate that. And so I'm really more like I'll rarely read a whole story. I still read the one thing I read online is the Guardian. I don't know about you, but just to, the English version of what's going on in America as well.
Yeah, unless it has to do with actual international football, because then the Guardian is just, they're a little bit too smug about the English influence for me.
That's what I like about it. It is smug, stiff upper lip, all that stuff, tally-ho. But they do, their entertainment is good. I mean, they do some really good features in music. That's the one thing I like. You know what I mean? Like, they've just, some of the British bands, they'll do like, Fine Young Cannibals, when they wrote one, an article that I was like, well, I didn't know all about this. And obviously the obvious ones that we can think of. But, all right. Whoa, there you go. So you've got your Huskies, 5-0. They're going down there to the Coliseum against a 7-2, 5-1 in conference USC team. First thoughts, impressions.
Bet the over. I think there's going to be a lot of points scored. USC could have just as easily lost to Cal. They stopped. It might have been their only stop of the game, stopping the 2-point conversion in the last minute. And while the Huskies have had a little hiccup in their offense, this might be a get healthy game against that USC defense. They don't look like they want to stop anybody. So, having said that, it's still USC, and it's still the Coliseum, and it's not going to be easy. But I think the Huskies, by having a few close games, they're probably better prepared for it now than they would have been coming off all the easy games.
Ah, that's a good point. I wasn't looking at it from that perspective. The other way, I thought that, okay, You know, they're struggling, but yeah, the two, you're right about that. And, you know, the Trojans two losses at Notre Dame and at Utah, those, you know, those are pretty good teams to, from their perspective, to lose from. But one thing here that I'm reading is the, of course, it'd be live, but this is USC's 100th homecoming weekend, welcoming back Trojans alumni from yesteryear.
Well, luckily they can't suit up Marcus Allen or any of those guys. And if they did, they're older than me, so that's okay. I'd be really worried if Reggie Bush got to suit up still. He still might want to try and reclaim his Heisman with one more big performance. But, you know, sometimes that can inspire you. Sometimes it can weigh on you. You might look around and see all those legends and go, what are we doing? You know, or do we really live up to this? And without knowing the guys, there's no way of knowing how they're going to respond. Some guys rise to that occasion and revel in it, and some guys shrink.
What's been your take on Michael Penix?
It seems something's not exactly right. And I don't know if it's his health or is he have so many things going on. He's lost a tiny bit of focus. They just haven't seemed to click the same way they were earlier in the season. Now, he's had to make some big throws recently. He's made a few. So, you know, he's had in a year and a half a hell of a career already for the Huskies. And, you know, I think this might be a game for him to get right. USC doesn't put that, or hasn't, I shouldn't say won't, but hasn't put that much pressure on the quarterback. If you give him time to sit back there and look for Rome and Jaden and those guys, that's a hell of a receiving core to deal with.
Absolutely. Michael Penix has been sick for the last 2 weeks, and Gary Grubb talked about that. Ryan Grubb, the offensive coordinator, said yesterday at the press conference that this is the first this is the healthiest he's been for the last 2 weeks. And to your point, I think you've got something there just in terms of if he's healthy, like Grubb said, this is the opportunity here to maybe get himself ahead of the Heisman Trophy, because you've got the returning Heisman Trophy candidate there. So, this is, a lot is on the line here.
I think he's proven he can rise to the occasion. You know, big moments against Oregon, big more moments in the November of last year. You know, he doesn't shy away from that, doesn't get scared. You know, he's willing to take the chances when he needs to. And, you know, head to head, I wouldn't be surprised to see him throw 4 or 5 touchdown passes this weekend.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, to your point, it would also be an anomaly if he didn't throw at least 3, right? Just the way that he's been playing, despite, like your observation, he's just off center a little bit. But, I think the UW defense obviously has to rise to the occasion. And I'm not going to play the video because from yesterday, the press conference, that'll take up too much of our time. But obviously, Caleb Williams, the way that he gets the ball out of his hands and the way that they get the ball out to the playmakers will challenge, I think, obviously, the UW D-line and also the linebackers.
Yeah, for sure. But they don't have to make that many plays. Based on USC's defense so far this year, you know, it's not going to take stopping them 4 or 5, 6 times. It might only take stopping them 2 times. You know, and it's going to be a departure from the last couple of weeks, I think, where you saw they had to grind things out and they were tougher. It might be, like I said, it might be a track meet, and you might just have to wait for USC to drop the baton.
All right, fair enough. There we are. Interesting to see that. All right, let's do this. Speaking of football, we'll switch the other one. And so what'd you think? What'd you think of your Sounders?
You know, it's interesting because I heard a lot of people talk about the 2 missed chances that Dallas had, which both on mistakes. But the Sounders could have been up by two goals already by that point. They came out of the blocks pretty quickly, and they had a few good chances and a few good looks that they didn't really take advantage of. The mistakes, you know, whether, you know, Jackson's pass to Tencio, probably on the wrong side of him, you know, he played to the unprotected side, but Tencio was probably a little too casual. And, but you're not going to get through a game without any mistakes and without any team having any chances. And if you look back on it and said, all right, if they finish a decent percent of their chances and we finish a decent percent of our chances, so maybe they score one of those two, but maybe we score one more too. So, and once they got ahead, I don't think they ever looked in trouble. You know, once they got ahead by the first goal, I think it was, you know, a workmanlike job to just continue on and take care of it. They never looked pressured.
All right, so we're going to have a surprise guest join us. That's it's Russell Brown, who's supposed to come in on the other segment. But Russell, come on in. We were at the game last night as well, and then we did a post game on the pitch. And also he's with Seattle University. But we ain't – you get 30 seconds to talk about the Red Hawks. Are you in, Russell?
Yeah, what do you mean just Russell? I see how it is. I see how it is right here. No love.
I started going a special guest. I'm like, shoot, if I got Pete on, he might think that Peter might think we'll bring in some of Vito, some of the old yesteryear guys.
Oh, just me.
Hey, nah. They don't need to be old to be special.
All right, so you know the legend there, but Russell, you got the legend on U.S. U.S. soccer men's legend, but a little bit more to Peter's point that. The Sounders did look comfortable once they got ahead. And how important is that leading into the next game?
Yeah, it's huge. We talked about the new format. It doesn't necessarily matter how many goals you score. Obviously, a win's a win. And it counts to the two you need to move on to the next round. But it's a confidence builder. You talked about, Maz. You know, you could score two goals, you score three, and it's deflating to FC Dallas. If you're in Seattle and you lose 3-0 or you lose 4-0 or something, yeah, it's the same as losing 1-0 in the overall scheme of things, but it's deflating and it's hard, and it gives the Sounders a little bit of boost, especially this unbeaten run. A lot of them were just draws, so the fact to get a big win to extend that unbeaten streak to 10, I think the Sounders are just playing with extreme confidence in that PK, whether you think it's a PK or not. It lifted the Sounders and it really boosted them there in the second half.
Before I ask Peter, the Red Hawks men's team is ranked number 10 in the nation?
12 right now. 12. The new rankings will come out in a little bit, so we'll be sure to push that forward. But 12 for now, sniffing a top 10.
Yeah, Peter, would you have ever thought about that? Because that one of your best buddies kind of built that whole program over there. 12th in the nation. What do you think about the Red Hawks?
It's... In some ways, it's not surprising. Seattle's been a soccer hotbed for a long time. And when I was in school and shortly thereafter, Seattle U was, to be generous, a train wreck. but you know, they've come a long way. And they've won some big games. They've taken some big scalps. They, you know, beat UCLA when UCLA was still one of the top teams in the country in the playoffs a few years ago. I think it's only a matter of time once they got someone in charge and once the administration got behind them again. You know, leaving Division One, de-emphasizing sports, set them back a long ways. And it's been a process, but since the administration has got behind it again, they've done great.
All right, just so we go right back to the Sounders there. And Peter, are you, to Russell's point, are they in rhythm now in terms of the, you know, offensively and how they're attacking?
I think so. And I think everyone's kind of settled in to what their roles are now. You know, it's been a big change to have to go away from Ladero is your key playmaker, though he came in and did a great job of keeping the tempo and holding the ball and moving the ball when he came on. But that's been your main go-to guy. And Ruiz Diaz has been your number one finisher, and that's who you've looked to. So to have those guys coming off the bench and the other guys stepping up and embracing their roles, Jordan has become a number nine. I mean, I think if we looked, it might be the majority of his goals are headers now. After very few, I mean, he had the one that bounced up and he tapped in against Dallas for his hat trick years ago from almost on the goal line. But in his first 5 years, those headed goals were few and far between. Now he's a threat in there and he's getting on the end of things. Knew who's actually become a good crosser of the ball, whereas before he could get into that spot and it was like no one knows where it was going. Alex and Christian have got back in that rhythm of working that right side to get in behind people. Leo Chu's a one-on-one option out wide that gives them problems. And I think they've all kind of settled in and said, okay, this is how we're going to do it. And this is what's going to work for us. And, you know, first they've made themselves hard to beat through that, as Russell talked about during that unbeaten streak, but a lot of them were draws and low scoring. Now they're going out and winning games. And that evolution has taken place. And I think they have confidence and other teams also look and go, oh boy, maybe they are back to that kind of stage where that's a team that's going to be a tough out in this playoffs.
Yeah. And then I thought Leo was a little tentative for the first 10, 15 minutes, maybe 20. Then he kind of got gritty, you know, dirty in the game. And what I mean by that is, you know, the tough tackles, not dirty as a dirty player, but, you know, he got into trenches, which I think you need to in the playoffs. Stefan Frey is not talked about enough. Russ, you talked about that, but what are you both seeing from him?
Go ahead, Russ.
He's a big game performer, and we talk about it all the time. How many iconic Sounder moments are because of Steph Frey's gloves? You can go to the MLS Cup, the first one they won, that saving Josie Altidore's shot, you know, that's kind of where it sprung him into the national spotlight, but not enough where he's keeper of the year, obviously, if we talked about and we've harped on and all that, but he just steps up in big moments. And when it seems like the momentum could have easily been in FC Dallas's favor yesterday, he comes up and makes big saves. And it's just, that's what he does. He's a big game performer and he's just so calm and cool and collected back there that it helps. Yes, it helps when your center backs are as great as they are, but the fact that you know you have solid gloves behind you, I mean, it just, he's been huge for this club. And I think right behind Nicolas Ladero, I honestly think he's the biggest Sounder to ever wear the Raven Green.
You know, I think it is interesting. He doesn't get the acclaim. He's not flamboyant. He doesn't do a lot of things, but he's a calming influence as well. And he's got some excitable guys playing in front of him. I mean, Nuhu, you know, Jackson gets a little bit excited sometimes. Even Alex, you know, he's a calming influence for them. And he doesn't have to make a ton of saves. But like you said, he steps up and makes the big one when it's needed. And in a completely different way, because they were the most high-scoring team around at the time, he's a little bit like Grant Fuhr for the old Edmonton Oilers. He'll make the big save when it's a momentum turner. You know, he might not make a save in a 4-0 game or that, so he loses out on something. But when that push comes to shove, where this might be the only save he has to make in the game to change the game, he's come up time and time again for him. And, you know, I think the team plays with that confidence in front of him as well. It's like, all right, if we do have a breakdown, he'll bail us out the one or two times he needs to.
You know, you mentioned something, both of you did. Russell, you said obviously his skill is a shot saver, right? And then Peter, you did, you know, that influence in the back, What about his kind of leadership from there, his ability to distribute the ball? You talked about the calming, but what about his ability to get the ball out? And I think the way the game is now, that keeper can be a point guard.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's still not among the elite as far as a passer of the ball, but his decision-making is good. He knows what he can and can't do. You see, some of these keepers, all of a sudden, someone confused them and told them they were Modric, and they're trying to play outside of the footballs around people and this and that, and they can get away with five, and they give away one, and it gives away a goal. He makes the plays he can make. When he can't, there's nothing wrong with sending it 60 yards away if there's not a pass. He's going to look to play first and try and play his way out, but he's not going to force it. And I think some of these people have it so ingrained in their head that they should never kick it long that they shoot themselves in the foot too often.
Right on. Okay, just a couple minutes maybe. I think we might have one more. Russell, will you roll call on Seattle University Sports right quick before we do a round robin here?
Yeah, definitely. We talked about it on men's soccer, currently ranked 12th, probably going to go up higher. They have a first-round bye in the WAC tournament next week. Women's soccer already in the semifinals. Currently, they will play tomorrow against California Baptist, who is the host on the women's side. And then both basketballs getting underway. New coaching staff, women's basketball, and Skylar Young taking over there. And then we already know about Chris Victor and what he's done back-to-back 21 seasons taking over that program. So exciting times here in fall sports wrapping up and winter sports getting underway.
All right. Before we go, both of you real quickly, but Peter, how do you attack? How do you go into next Saturday's game?
I don't think they need to change much. I think you don't need to worry about us coming out. I think they really did make a concerted effort to come out fast and go from the start. I think you can play a little bit closer to the vest and play on the counter a little bit. I think in some ways Jordan becomes even more dangerous this way because you can soak up a pressure. They need to go get a win. So they need to try and go and get goals. And while they're good going forward at times, they do leave some gaps. And Leo Chu on the break, Jordan on the break, Christian making those runs out of the midfield because he does such a good job of unbalancing teams by going at the right time. I think there'll be chances to be had, and I wouldn't be surprised to see him catch them. And, they get ahead one, then I think it's really an uphill battle for Dallas.
Russell?
Yeah, that was Peter said exactly what you and I said yesterday, Maz, in a post game on the bench. You go out there and you already have that one game in your pocket. You're already playing well. FC Dallas is going to be pushing to try to get that goal, knowing they have to keep their season alive. And I think you hit them on the counter from there on out. I think, cards are in your deck and just finish the game off. But I do think it's important for a veteran team like the Sounders to get this two-game sweep and rest some of those legs.
All right, gentlemen, thank you for hopping on board. We're going to continue as long as the Sounders continue, and then after that. So that was Peter Hattrup. He's U.S. Soccer men's U.S. Soccer men's team legend. And then, of course, Russell Brown of Seattle University Sports. All right, so D-Money, I know we got to go. Y'all, thank you for watching and listening. Clean Green Living is next. I'm Mazvita Maraire. Thanks to everyone. Thank you.